Hello and welcome to the Let's Talk Learn Tech podcast. I'm your host Pranjali Lahiri, talking to you about balancing tight L&D budgets. It's our debut podcast and we're super excited to bring this to you all the way from Pune, India. Joining me today are three gentlemen who understand clients and their L&D budgets better than anyone else. Amit Gautam, our CEO and Director, Amar Pawar, AVP Technology, and Sunil Kamath, Senior Business Development Manager. Hey guys, welcome to the podcast.
Hello Pranjali.
Hi Pranjali, pleasure to be here.
Hello Pranjali.
Well, it's an interesting mix we have got here with all of you representing different functions and hence different perspectives. I can't wait to see how this unfolds for us. All right, so let's get to the meat of the matter. First up, I think it's a question I'll probably ask Sunil. Sunil, you've been on the other side of the table. You've been a part of L&D. So what do you think about L&D budgets and mainly how do they impact the overall training success?
Right. So Pranjali, L&D budgets have always been a debatable topic and I think it all is very industry specific. So depending on how well is the industry or the company doing is when the CFO or the CEO of the company will allocate a certain amount of budget towards L&D initiatives. And that's when that money is put aside. So, and that is really crucial for the success of learning and development, for the success of digitization and everything, because money is important and the budgets are really, really important. And to be honest, they somehow are wafer thin in most industries. So that's where the major challenge lies. But then within that budget is how you can invest and return on the investment is what remains as a challenge for learning and development functions within industries and companies.
Okay, interesting. And you mentioned that there is a correlation, if I can say so, between the budget and the success. And this is where I'm going to go to Amar. Amar, you work with multiple clients across different industries and geographies. Do you really see there is a correlation? Is it linear? Is it multifactorial when it comes to a direct impact of the L&D budget on the training success?
Absolutely, Pranjali. You know, a budget may end up defining the quality of the content or, you know, the what they wish to create or what they wish to subscribe. They might also, you know, have limitation in terms of the options that are available in terms of, you know, training their workforce. And definitely budget has a direct and a huge impact on that. So, yes.
Okay. Amit, a follow-up question to what Amar and Sunil have been telling me. Do you see a similar theme or is there a differentiation point that you see on this?
I think Amar and Sunil both raise very valid points. So, you know, see, any L&D activity or a program or an intervention in any company is itself a multi-factor or multi, you know, stakeholder activity. Now, when this happens, so while yes, the primary point to start within any company is the culture of learning and also the mindset and the attitude of the top management behind how they want to see the learning and development function as. Now, having said that, once they, you know, find it as a critical part of their organization development, then all these activities they define or programs they define, they would need resources. This could be, you know, very basic time of the employees who are in these activities, either on the training side or the trainer side. And from there, it could also involve resources which need, you know, tangible cash to be spent or other resources which need money to be spent. So yes, of course, there is a direct impact of how much a budget an L&D department or a function gets and how they can utilize that budget to perform or, you know, kind of use it, put it to use for their employees. So yes, there is a direct correlation. Now, the causation part is a little tricky because, you know, it does not work as a linear proportion that you spend more and you get more. So the key would be to be able to identify the right activities, and it could differ from employee to employee, team to team, and then allocate budgets accordingly. So just spending a double budget every year does not guarantee double performance in terms of the skills or the resources or the employees every year. So yes, the correlation is definitely very strong that if you are able to spend more, that means you are able to give more to your employees in terms of the avenues and the resources, but it has to be very, very aptly measured and defined for each employee, for each team, and even for your key objectives of the company.
So yes, we've been speaking about there is a training success and there is, you know, how much of the L&D budget has been allocated to that. But how much do you think or how do you think rather this impacts the overall decision making? Amar, you have some thoughts on that? How would a L&D budget actually affect the overall decision making when it comes to the training interventions? for a particular company?
See, mainly what I believe, you know, the L&D budgets maturity level, you know, defines a lot in that. But definitely, you know, their geographies and their, you know, their language barriers, you know, they also come into picture. So I'll give you an example. So, you know, somebody who has a mature L&D, you know, team might still face a problem in defining a training strategy for a user group, you know, in a company where, you know, their user group is primarily into oil rigs or a mining industry, right? Now, basic challenges are availability of internet, availability of devices who are connected, and, you know, how they are going to provide this training. So they might need to actually spend a lot when compared to, you know, industries like, you know, software. So, you know, that's basically what, you know, defines their entire training approach, the training budget, and, you know, also the mechanism that they are going to use for their training.
All right. I'm going to turn to Sunil. And Sunil, this is, you are in sales, mm-hmm. and you will be the most appropriate person to ask this question. How do you think this impacts? Because normally when people talk to us, when they have a requirement and we have to give them a solution to that requirement, how do you think the budget plays a role and how much so in that decision making for them?
Right. So Pranjali, I think the fact that, you know, you have to link learning and development. Generally, we know it as a fact that learning and development continues to be a support function that supports the business. In most industries, it's never the revenue earning department that brings in the money. So they will always have budgets which will not be invested. Most companies may not invest heavily into learning and development. But at the end of the day, like Amar said, you know, it depends on the industry. So when there is a compliance angle that comes inside, where you can have lawsuits that could be filed, which turn out to be millions of dollars, when you have some companies that require a certain amount of training to be delivered, it could be health and safety, it could be audits, it could be government rules and regulations, local legislations, which require a particular workforce to be trained on certain skills. That is when learning and development, digitization, LMS systems, e-learnings, these products come into picture, and they do a fantastic job at delivering the required compliances. So I think that's where, you know, as a salesperson, I do tend to speak about these aspects very, very strongly whenever I'm talking to prospects. It is also depends on which industry they come from, and to highlight these important aspects which can result in them, you know, saving a lot of money if they have an audit that comes up. So it's basically about saving yourself from, you know, untoward situations which might arise, and utilizing a platform like a learning management system to leverage that. So I think it all depends on how you pitch that and how do you make them realize that how a learning management system or e-learning can benefit them, you know, depending on the industry and the function that they come from.
It's a perfect segue for me to go to Amit. And Amit, my question is, this is something Amar mentioned and Sunil also mentioned as a part of what he just said. How do you think the entire L&D budget allocation really differ as per one, the industry, second, the geography? Again, is there a combination of these or everything really just comes down to the L&D maturity of that particular company?
I think from a company standpoint, the industry they operate in is definitely a very, very big factor in terms of the focus itself on the L&D activities, because as Sunil mentioned about the compliance and the risk involved if you are not compliant, you know, not just the legal lawsuits, but also, you know, just health and safety of the employees in the company. Now, if you are working in an industry which has, you know, which demands health and safety or work and safety, food and safety, compliances, then of course the L&D budget has to have a direct proportion of that allocation on in those areas in terms of compliance and other areas to support that part. And then in terms of geographies, I think you know, it's a fact that there is a different level of understanding, maturity, and the way you look at L&D function across different countries and different regions. So, you know, there could be a difference in the way they look at L&D in developed countries, in emerging markets. So based on that, you know, how critical they look at the function overall. And then I think the third factor is that, you know, L&D, like any other thing, is like, you know, at a very basic level, two-step pyramid. So one is a must-have activities and then the good-to-have activities. Now, for some industries and some geographies, the must-have activities may be a larger part of the overall cycle than the good-to-have. Like, you know, compliance or, you know, legal risk assessment and everything else. And for some geographies and industries, that may be a smaller part, and they're good to have maybe more from a competition standpoint or aspirational standpoint or how the company wants to move forward. So I think from these two perspectives, so the allocation of the budget directly is dependent on which industry you are operating in and which geography you are, you know, mainly operating from. But yes, I think the commonality between all of these is how you look at your function, and then it percolates to what all your division of activities is, and then the allocation of budget happens as per that. Sometimes the companies may not be able to allocate budgets to, let's say, maybe only able to allocate budget to just good to have and some must have, or you know, in any form. But yes, the dependence is definitely on the industry and the geography they work from.
Right. So to add to the compliance and, you know, the other aspects, I think a quality induction program goes a long way in ensuring L&D success. Because when someone joins into a new company, the way that he or she gets treated, the way that he or she gets, you know, a couple of trainings that help him or her to get adjusted into the new workplace, I think all of these factors directly are proportional to whether they will spend a lot of time in the company or whether they will quit within a couple of months. And the amount that a company spends in recruiting and retaining talent is directly proportional to the quality of induction that he or she gets when he or she joins that particular company. So products like learning management systems digitize the whole experience, give them a quality induction program, which directly is responsible for the success of the, you know, learning and development or someone joining a company and lasting there for a long period of time. So whenever you have budgets that are put aside, a quality induction is something that every company needs to invest in heavily and think this through, because that will directly be proportional to the talent and retention of talent within that particular company.
L&D maturity is another factor. Now, Amar, I want to understand from you, and this is maybe from the experience that you have from working across 150 clients that we have across different geographies and different industries, essentially, how is L&D maturity one defined? And do we see certain industries or geographies having a higher maturity? Yes, Amit mentioned that certain developing countries may have a different maturity compared to the emerging ones. But between industries and maturity, do you think there is a linearity that we can establish?
I believe, the countries and certain regions are definitely, you know, having much more mature in terms of, you know, their L&D maturities is far more better than, you know, some of the others, which are, you know, right now it's like kind of picking up. In terms of industry, industries which are technology driven are, you know, picking up L&D quite well in terms of the maturity, as well as, you know, the content that is being provided for training, or the different variety of training methods and methodologies that have been applied to get the users, you know, on board onto any platform or to deliver those training. I think definitely, you know, these industries are much more mature. Certain industries which are, you know, workforce driven, you know, they would focus on L&D from a very specific, you know, a narrow region, you know, at least in some of the regions which are not yet that mature, you know, in terms of, you know, they would focus only on the compliance requirements, or they might only focus on their particular service, but they are not focusing on something like a growth of a particular, you know, workforce, or, you know, what's next for them. So yes, there is slight correlation, but yes, there is definitely, you know, industry does come into picture, but major things are, you know, in terms of their, you know, a particular region or a country might have a better L&D maturity just because of the resources that are available locally for them.
Okay, understood. And this is where we get to the hard-hitting question. So if we are agreeing that L&D budgets are critical for the success, for overall decision-making, how can businesses get a bang for their buck? Sunil, you mentioned a term, wafer-thin budgets. So if the budgets are really that slim, how can a business or L&D in general make the best out of this?
Right. So Pranjali, that is a tricky proposition, because it all boils down to this one word which everybody knows but nobody knows the answer to, which is ROI. So how do you really calculate return on investment? So you have the budget, they may be wafer thin, they may be high. So whenever you put aside money towards an initiative, what is the outcome of that initiative in terms of investment? Is the workforce getting better? Are they becoming more productive? Are they becoming more efficient? Are the number of accidents reducing? Are more sales being closed once you train a sales force, for example? I think setting up metrics right at the outset is very, very crucial. So this is something that most companies talk about, but when it comes to actual implementation, that's where most companies also fail. So setting this up right at the outset, when you allocate a certain amount of budget towards an L&D initiative, it's not about taking people out into a, you know, offsite, giving them a good experience, taking them to a picnic. That's not what L&D is all about. It's about whether you're trying to make the workforce more capable, more efficient, and setting up these metrics right at the beginning, whether we're going to measure someone before they got trained and after they got trained, and how are they getting more efficient, more productive. Certain metrics need to be set right at the outset, so the expectations are set, and then delivering per those expectations with initiatives that will add value to the business is where the whole thing boils down to eventually. You know, so I think there's a lot of planning that has to go into any initiative right from the beginning to ensure its success and to result in the function's success per se as a whole.
So we spoke of objective setting, objective achievement, which is essentially what ROI would be. Amit, what are your views, not just on ROI, but how can L&D in general, again, make the most out of whatever budgets they have, thin or fat, whichever way it goes?
So yes, I think as Sunil mentioned, L&D has to work in two ways and at the same time. One is they have to keep working with the management on the metrics they can deliver on, you know, either the success or the performance of the L&D initiatives. You know, they could be either positive matrices, like if we do this, this will happen, or they could be also the risk matrices that if you do not do this, then this will definitely happen. So as long as they can deliver some matrices to the management about either the lag, what happens if there's no training or L&D activity in the right manner, or the ones which say if you do this, how is our revenue going to increase or the margins going to increase. So that is one thing. And the second is, I think, given the budgets may always be thin or they may still not be very thin, what they need to definitely do is to, you know, do a proper diligence on what kind of tools, what kind of activities, interventions. So everything has to be designed from a perspective of the outcome and the objective. Sometimes, you know, I've seen in our experiences that, you know, some of the people we interact with, they are looking at a solution, let's say an LMS or an intervention purely from a technology perspective without understanding how does it really impact the user in terms of the engagement, in terms of the learning values. So I think if L&D works on these both factors, so one is working with management to create more matrices for measurement and properly defining the objectives of what they want to do and then designing the interventions accordingly and also looking for technology which matches those objectives, I would say most of the cases, and we have seen that in the past with our customers, they would be able to deliver solutions which have great value and they may not really demand a lot of money from the customer.
Amar, any thoughts you want to add?
So, you know, taking it ahead from both Sunil and, you know, what Amit just covered, you know, I basically, you know, in my experience when I'm working with, you know, a lot of the L&D champions, I try to, you know, ask them to focus on, you know, five key areas generally. The very first one, you know, is to know your user group. Know their needs, know their requirements, you know, what would, you know, really make them take up a training and, you know, achieve the goal that, you know, you have tried to set it for them. So, you know, regarding the RO point which Sunil was mentioning, you know, exactly you need to be aware of what exactly are your goals post conducting this particular, training and the agenda of these training. Second is, you know, identifying the core areas which are specific to your business, your service or your product. And, you know, so one of the biggest or the largest component of any L&D budget is the, you know, the decision of how to deliver this training and, you know, do we need to create any of our own content, right? So what I generally suggest to our, you know, to our customers is to only focus on, you know, creating content when it is specific to their, you know, areas of business or services. And for rest of them, which are like generic content on general content, you know, for example, soft skill, leadership training, compliance and all these areas, there are readily available catalog courses which are available. And, you know, you should try to, you know, find the right one which fits your need and, you know, try to subscribe to them rather than creating it again on your own. And this can be a very, you know, have a high impact on your budget. Lastly, you know, try to get as many options in terms of the training, you know, that you can conduct, because the more the options that are available, to your user, you know, the more you know, the users would be able to, you know, take up and take up the training and, you know, provide you a higher ROI. And yes, the awareness, you know, the awareness part is important. You know, I've been seeing that a lot of, you know, enterprises are investing heavily on, you know, also investing heavily on their training content and everything. But the fact of the matter is, you know, their users are not aware that, you know, there is some kind of training available, you know. So a kind of an internal marketing or internal, you know, promotion of these trainings is very helpful, you know, and this goes a long way in trying to get a higher completion rate at the end of the year.
All right. So there we have it. Views and advice straight from the experts. Guys, before I let you go, I would like to play a quick round of rapid fire. I'm going to give each one of you a sentence and all you have to do is just complete it in the way that you think best fits. All right. So I'm going to start with Amit. The sentence for you is L&D budgets are
needed and they need to be allocated very, very efficiently for the right activities.
All right, Sunil, L&D budgets should be?
Okay, L&D budgets should be thought of carefully depending on what are you trying to achieve. If you're trying to achieve 20% reduction in accidents, then the initiatives have to correspond to that and the budget has to obviously correspond to that. So I think what you're trying to achieve, your objectives, is what defines what the budget should be.
Okay, Amar, the last one for you. L&D budgets are not?
So L&D budget is not about cost, but it's about the value that you can provide to the company.
Awesome. That's our time, guys. To all our listeners, thank you for listening to our number one episode. We would love for you to connect with us on LinkedIn. See you next month. Bye-bye.